Hey, good afternoon, everybody. I hope some of you skipped work to be here. I've been skipping it for the last 20 years. We are so excited about this award presentation today, the 2018 Golden Key Award for Excellence in Cinematic Arts. We owe a great deal of gratitude to Eric Kohn from IndieWire, who's been so instrumental in helping us put this together. And I wanted to introduce to you Eric Kohn, senior editor of IndieWire, who's going to be our moderator today for the Carmody Print Trip.
I skipped to work too. Thank you. It's so great to see such a nice crowd of people here on a nice sunny day. I thought I was the biggest Harmony Korine fan here, but is a couple from Nashville in the audience somewhere? These folks came all the way from Nashville for this conversation, and we'll hear from them in the Q&A too, but that's a level of commitment I don't know if I can muster. But I will tell you, in the fall of 2012, I think it was, I went down to Nashville and visited Harmony at his house for a long-term research project I was working on, and I got a chance to go through the insane volume of archives in his basement, where I found all kinds of fascinating landmark moments in his career kind of coming to life, from this love letter from, I think, Jean-Luc Godard to a death threat from Larry Clark. So it really covered the full spectrum of all these different career highlights. And it continued when we went driving around Nashville to all these places where they shot this amazing movie you might have heard of called Gummo. And we went to all these amazing neighborhoods where you saw the movie coming to life. And one of the things that I think is really interesting about Harmony's work, if you're familiar with it at all, is that he has this reputation of being kind of a provocateur who shows us things that are weird or different or designed to make us uncomfortable. But usually that's because we're just not exposed to those places. And what I've found that's so fascinating about Harmony is that he's almost like an anthropologist, in that he goes into these places and he brings us closer to places we never would have known about. And he kind of did that in Nashville as much as he could, and then he found his way down here to Florida. So it was only a matter of time after Spring Breakers, and now with The Beach Bum, which we'll get a sneak peek at tonight, that he found his way to the Key West Film Festival. So we're really glad that we were able to honor him in this particular context at this moment in his career. So before we go any further, let's take a look at a highlight reel that it's a sort of an overview of Harmony's work, and then we'll hear more about Harmony.
You look so stupid, you look utterly stupid! If I were so stupid, I would slap my own face.
Thank you.
So to present the golden key to Harmony Korine, please welcome the Florida Keys Film Commissioner, Chad Newman.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My name is Chad Newman. I'm the film commissioner for the Florida Keys and Key West. Yes. Ooh, very exciting. I took over from Rita Troxell, if anyone knows and remember her. She retired in February, so I've got the gig now. And, you know, we're very honored tonight to have Harmony here. He has been a great friend to Florida, filming in Florida, and has been an incredible friend to Key West. And if anyone fits in here, it's definitely Harmony. Please, we're on behalf of the Key West Film Festival, we're happy to present the 2018 Golden Key Award to Harmony.
Thank you.
There you go, sir. It's thanks, all yours.
Thanks, man.
Thank you so much.
Wow, that's good. It's like a sex toy.
Oh, Alton.
Awkward pause here. So, yeah, I'll take that. It'll be there when you're done.
Turn that into a necklace.
It's a lot of things you could turn this thing into. The natural starting point for having you here and talking about your work is Florida, because you spent so much time in Nashville, and then obviously Spring Breakers was this turning point. But what was it about Florida that attracted you in the first place?
I just love the fuckery here. It's just like, it's super twitchy. And like, I just love what goes on in Florida. And also like South Florida, like the more ratchet, the better. I just feel like it's the cosmic runoff for the rest of the states. And you know, for me, I fit in perfect in this bitch.
Well, exactly. I mean, talk about Spring Breakers in that respect, because one of the things that I think is so amazing about that movie is that, yeah, there's like a genre element to it, but a lot of times we're just kind of hanging out and seeing the scene. So, you know, what was the process like for you in figuring out like who you wanted in that movie and figuring out kind of the scene that you really wanted to capture?
For Spring Breakers? I was always like, I kind of liked the idea of spring break when I grew up in Nashville. During like spring break time, everyone like jump in a car and drive to Panhandle, kind of redneck Riviera. And like, it was just this like part of youth. It was like this kind of like rite of passage. And I liked the name Spring Break. I like the idea of spring breaking. Like breaking spring, spring breakers, breaking spring, spring break breakers is beautiful. And so I wanted to, what happened was I hadn't really done anything at spring break for a long time. I hadn't gone on spring break, you know, probably in 30 years. So I flew to Daytona Beach, but it was just to do some research during spring break, but it was this lesbian bikers. And then they said that was Lesbian Biker Week. And that shit was rough, bro. They were like revving their engines all night. And it was crazy. And so I left and then went to, someone tipped me off and said it's actually in Panama City. So I went, and then that's where it was like crazy. And I checked into like a Holiday Inn during spring break in Panama City, you know, and there was just all the debauchery and everything. I just rode it. I drove out to this golf club on the outskirts of Panama City. And I think Hulk Hogan was there with some midgets. And they were filming like a reality show. And I just tapped into it. I can't tell you, I just tapped in and just rode it in like a week or something.
But so much about this movie is it's just like this free-flowing kind of narrative. And in some ways, it is similar to films that you made beforehand, but you had some big stars. The movie went on to have a lot of cultural resonance. What surprised you about that?
Well, what surprised me about it was it just existed. That I wanted to make a movie that was like a pop poem, something that was closer to like a piece of music or a pop song, something that was like a kind of more menacing, like Britney Spears song or something. And so That's why I felt like it needed to have those actresses that were in the movie, because they were of the culture of the time, and that reflected it in that a reflection of it at the same time. And then, you know, characters like the alien character, like dudes I went to school with, like, you know.
And then the other thing about the movie is that it got you here. So at that point, how much did it change the kind of movies you wanted to make? You went right into writing another movie that was set here, right?
Oh, after that, I wrote another movie, and this fucking thing fell apart.
So this is The Trap.
Yeah, it was called The Trap, and I was like a month off from making it. We're gonna shoot it in Miami.
And tell us a little bit about what was in
it. I'm gonna make it. I'm gonna go back and make it. But it's a movie. It's a gangster film. It's like almost like a genre film. It's like pure menace, and it's super violent, and it's about a rapper who lives in Star Island in Miami, and then the guy gets out of prison and that he grew up with, it comes for him. And it was a big cast, so it was a pretty large budget for me, and it was all ready, and then one of the actors had some issues with the actors and a scheduling conflict, and then it knocked everybody's schedule off. And rather than get depressed or freaked out, I was like, you know, I'm gonna make something. I need to make something right away. So I wanted to write something that's the opposite of that, and I wanted to write I felt like a comedy, felt like laughing. I wanted to do something that was more like a stoner vibe, and that's when I wrote the Beach Bum.
So the Beach Bum, you've got Matthew McConaughey, a guy who, you know, was this kind of iconic stoner comedy face in a way for a long time, and then there's this whole thing that happened that people call the McConaissance, where he became a different kind of actor. What was it like to approach him about getting him to kind of go back to his roots, as it were?
It's good because, in a way, it's something that the idea of what it is something that people are familiar with, maybe, or think, or project onto him, but really I don't think he's ever really played anything like it. When you see it, you'll understand, but it kind of plays with the idea of what people imagine him to be. It kind of takes it into another realm a little bit. So I always like playing with the persona, the real life persona, the pop persona, and then what's real, what's not real, what's authentic to the person and what's made up, and that kind of twists it and pushes it out into the stratosphere.
So at least on the surface, the Beach Bum might have the most plot of any movie you've done. What can you tell us about what this movie is, essentially?
It's a comedy. It's a movie. I wanted to just make people crack up, and it's a kind of fuck it all movie. It's a lot about getting stoned and just like relaxing, enjoying the moment, and it's about a character with complete reckless abandon and an inner gift of, maybe some would say, genius and inner poetry, and how he reconciles the debauchery with the genius.
And what's his name?
Moondog.
So you may have noticed there's already a cafe named after him.
Yeah, I noticed there's a restaurant here that coincidentally.
So you shot all over Key West, right? So what was it like shooting here?
It's great. I love it here. I mean, it's one of my favorite places in America. It might be my favorite spot. And I come here all the time because I live in Miami, so I drive down here. It's a very special kind of strangeness to it. And I like it. I like hearing about what it was like before, too. And so, and I like being at the southernmost tip of the United States, being closer to Cuba than you are to Key Largo. It's interesting. But I just like the feel of it.
And your process is different from a lot of filmmakers in that you're kind of open to chance in a way. So what sort of challenges does that present when you have this incredibly high-profile actor? Everybody knew you were shooting this movie, that he was around. People were looking to see McConaughey as Moondog roaming the streets of Florida. So, you know, what kind of challenges did that create for you?
It was just hard when he was, you know, because his character pees all the time. And, like, he pees off of, like, all these boat decks and, like, all the, and the docks. And he's, like, just pee, you know, because you drink so much beer, you got to pee. So a lot of times we would just film him drink and pee, you know, because that's probably one of the purest things you can do as a human, simultaneously drink and pee. And so we're trying to tap into that's the essence of his character, is someone who's taking in and giving out and putting out all the time, sucking in the world and then peeing it out. So Key West was a perfect place for that.
Let me ask you about the practical challenges of shooting Matthew McConaughey peeing all over town.
Practical challenge? It was just you know, you get a crowd around a schlong and...
Real or fake?
That I'm not going to get into.
We do have a clip from The Beach Bum, which nobody's seen it before. So this is there are trailers out there, but this is...
It's a scoop, clip. Yo.
So you want to set it up at all?
This is just a scoop, yo. This is the actually this part was shot in Miami, but this is a scene early, in the middle movie where his daughter is getting married, and he's late for the wedding.
And cool. It's just that's pretty much all you need to know. Yeah. Let's take a look at the clip from The Beach Bum.
Our daughter's wedding. Melting down. Okay, well, hurry up, please.
I love you, baby.
You're stressing me.
I'm on my way.
Okay, the wedding is starting. Lingerie, let's hit it, baby.
Love between a boy and a girl can be so wonderful, especially when it's a girl that I've known ever since she was born. Heather, you know I love you and I love your family, and I'm so happy to see you get married today. To him. And you gotta be ready to take on everything that she stands for, and that includes her.
So you wrote this role for Snoop Dogg, basically, right?
Yeah, I wrote it for Snoop, but then he said, he called me, because it was written, and then he called me and he said, but I have one change. And I was like, what is it? He was like, I have one note. And he's like, I want to be called, I want to be called Lingerie.
Because you wrote it in the script as Snoop Dogg.
Yeah, he's like, I want to be Lingerie. He was like, you can call me Ray, short for Lingerie. And he's like, because I'm smooth and silky. And I was like, that's a great note. Like, lingerie. And then it was great because he was, you know, he gets so high that his clothes actually say Snoop on it in the movie because he wanted to wear his own clothes. They say Snoop Dogg, but his name is Lingerie. I was going to correct it, but I just liked it.
So the hybrid fiction, nonfiction thing going on there. Well, and the thing about your shooting style is that you are very open to improvisation. You shoot scenes multiple different ways a lot of times. So what's it like working with actors like Snoop Dogg and McConaughey in terms of, you know, getting them to do what you need them to do while also kind of creating enough freedom for them?
Yeah, because I kind of, what I do is I don't really do continuity in the traditional way. So I kind of shoot the movie, I'll shoot it almost like into the entire film, like two or three times over in different locations. Because I never know where, what I'm going to like really until I am cutting and putting it together. But once it's a very non-traditional way of covering a film or shooting, and it's always really rolling, I never really stop. I just keep going, just doing it again in different places and in different different readings and stuff. I don't call it really improvising. I mean, it's some of, there's some improvising. It's more, but improvising is not really the, it's more like, I say, it's like riffing. It's like a kind of controlled, it's like, more like riffing off of something maybe that's written or an idea, as opposed to just making things up. It's more like it's like riffing.
And it must be interesting to bring some like notable actors who've worked on, you know, big film shoots, not just McConaughey, but you got Martin Lawrence in there.
Yeah.
I mean, what's it like to work with a guy like that in this context?
It was great. It's a great cast. That movie's really, it's a great cast. Martin is like one of my favorite comedic actors ever. And it was, I knew he hadn't really done much in a while. And so by choice, I don't think he had been acting for a while. And then when I wrote the character of Captain Whack, I was really, he's the one I wanted to play. So I was so thrilled when he did it. He's great. He's just comic genius.
And tell us about his car in the movie.
His car is based on this, some of you Key West dudes might know it, that coconut car. You know that one has all the coconuts? And I was going to use the coconut car, but then it could only drive like a quarter of a mile without, and the gear shift was made of coconut. And so we had to replicate exactly, but then we turned it into something else, but the coconut dude, I think, was pissed.
He's worried about his IP or something. So one of the things that's really interesting about talking about the Beach Bum is that, you know, some people might be surprised to see you working in a popular register with the stoner comedy genre, but there's always been humor in your work. Even Kids, which some of us have revisited a lot over the years, has actually got a lot of funny moments to it. I'm sort of curious about, you know, going through that experience where you wrote that movie, you were still a teenager, how that informed the kind of filmmaker that you wanted to be.
Huh, that's an interesting question. Because I was so young, it informed it because, in a lot of ways, because it was a movie that I didn't direct, I wrote it, and so I got to watch the process without having to be the director. So that was good. It was at that time in my life, I was really obsessed with movies, youth films, this kind of like movies like Il Bidone and Pichot and Over the Edge and Rumblefish or The Outsiders, movies that had this kind of, were based in truth but pushed into something that was like slightly more fantastical. And so it was fun because I was just starting to establish, at least internally, things that would later become like hallmarks of what I try to do. And then it was great because no one in that movie had ever done anything before. We were all just first time, mostly just kids on the street and hanging out. And so it was everyone's first thing. So there was pressure in some ways because none of us really knew what we were doing, but there was also, it was great because we didn't know what we were doing. And so it was fun for me to watch a director who was obsessive and had a vision. It was singular, and it was a great process.
So then you make Gummo, which, you know, it sort of existed in a category of its own, and one of the things that was kind of fascinating about that is you were still kind of finding your way creatively, going around, getting noticed, people wanted to talk to you about things, and you kind of scored this really interesting advocate early on in Werner Herzog, who saw that movie and became a big supporter of it. When did you first connect with him, and what sort of advice did he give you at that stage of your career?
He had seen Tom Luddy had shown him an early, I think before the movie came out, and And then I just got a phone call from him. He's like, you are the last foot soldier in the army. It is your duty to make films. And there is one scene in the movie where the kid is taking a bath in a dirty bath water. And for whatever reason, I taped a piece of raw bacon onto the back of the wall behind his head, just like I just scotch taped a piece of raw bacon onto the wall. And for some reason, Herzog was obsessed with the bacon. And he was just like, how did you do the bacon? And so a lot of it had to do with that bacon. And then I flew out to, I loved his movies. He was one of my favorite directors growing up. And I flew out to San Francisco and we've been friends ever since.
And Gummo was not a big hit when it came out. I mean, it actually got, you know, critically panned and stuff. It kind of took time to get out there and find the audience that it has now. What sort of advice did he give you at the time facing that?
It was crazy because on the one hand, it was winning, I was winning like awards or whatever festival, whatever the hell, at that time, the landscape of movies was different than it is now. And you really were dependent upon a lot of mostly mainstream publications. And criticism. And so in my mind, I had done this thing that was like, I had figured, I was a kid, you know, I was 23, 24, and I had figured even the people that hated the movie would see merit in the film. And they could see that there was goodness in the film. But then the New York Times wrote this article, Janet Maslin wrote this article, said it was the worst movie of the year. And I looked at that thing, that was in the days of faxes. And I remember I was like, it's fucking worse than 8 heads in a duffel bag? Are you kidding me?
So he called you?
So anyway, he called me laughing. He was like, this is the greatest thing for the movie ever. He was like, and he was like, in 10 years, you'll understand. He was like, this is destined for cult status. And then he hung up on me.
And it is true. I mean, Gummo did end up helping you in a lot of ways with your later work. I mean, Spring Breakers, you got some of the cast for that movie through fandom, right?
Yeah, it's cool. It's just, it's like everything. You try to fortify yourself in a way. I try to make movies that are very specific to the way I think, or things I want to see in a way that I want to see them. And there's a specific narrative structure and a pacing and a anti-narrative sometimes and characters, and I just do my best. I try to make joy with that. I try to make beautiful images and moments, and then I put the movies out there, and however they're received in the moment is one thing, and then usually it changes with time sometimes, and then but I just go on and keep making things. I don't ever really, I try not to like stop and analyze it too much because I'm always wrong. I'm just happy to be able to be in a place where I could keep creating. And then the films eventually find an audience and people see the work, sometimes never see it in the theater. They'll find it, you know, years after the fact, and it becomes something else.
One of the movies that you've made in the past decade that doesn't get discussed enough is Mr. Lonely, which is a film that is in some ways tonally a lot different from what you've done before. It's a kind of gentler, more melancholic piece of filmmaking. I'm sort of curious how that movie sits with you now. You hadn't made movies in a long time. You took a bit of a break, actually a pretty long break, in between Julian Donkey Boy and Mr. Lonely. Yeah. So what was it like to come back and make movies after such a long gap? Yeah. and make this thing that was so different from everything else you'd done?
Yeah, it's a weird movie. It's like an anomaly in my film career. It's probably the quietest. It's the movie that I made that the least people have seen, the least people talk about, the least people know about. It's probably the least, like, what, provocative, maybe. And I think there's a couple reasons for that. But yeah, I had kind of, I would say, retired from making movies, but I was a kid still. I was in my 20s, and I just stopped. I didn't want to make movies anymore. I just wanted to, like, go fishing and stuff. And then, finally, I started this lawn care business, and, you know, it was doing pretty good, but I wasn't getting what I needed. No, I'm just kidding. I felt like I had just it was a, there were certain things that I needed to see, like these nuns jumping out of airplanes without parachutes, and so I had these images and I kind of built a story around them. I think it's a movie that, for whatever reason, the time or whatever, it just didn't like really resonate. It has, for me, it has some of the pretty, the most, I think from my, just personally, the some of the most interesting images of anything I've, of any of the, anything I've filmed. And there's great moments in it, but yeah.
And Herzog's really great in that movie too.
Yeah, Herzog's good, really good. He was, we filmed him in Panama. He was hanging out with all the buzzards. He likes this thing, I go where the buzzards are.
One of the things that's also notable about that film is that around that time, it was like you had just kind of gotten back to Nashville and you settled down. You got married like right afterwards, right? So how did that aspect of your life, I mean, you'd been bouncing around a lot, you know, your work would seemed like it was very much kind of the product of the intensity of the creativity you were chasing. How did settling down, having a family, change you as an artist?
It's weird. It just made me feel like more gnarly. Like I just wanted to fuck it all up more.
You're afraid to stop rebelling, basically?
No, I don't know what it is. I just got anxious and I was like, damn, I got to keep, you know, I got to really fuck this thing up.
So you went from Mr. Lonely to Spring Breakers, basically.
Yeah, I got super, like, aggro.
But you also, you started doing some commercial work, and you've done shorts and things like that, but starting with the commercial side of it, what is doing that kind of work, how does that affect you creatively? How is it different from the way that you work on a film shoot, for example?
If I shoot ads, it's generally just, ad work is, I mean, I really like, I don't do them that often. I do like one a year or something. But it's nice because you're not, I mean, look, it's different if you're doing a douche commercial than if you're doing your own thing. So with a douche commercial, you could just be detached. You do not have to give your soul to the douche.
You could put that on a t-shirt and sell it on Duval with no problem. But it's, can we roll the douche commercial? No, we don't have that. But you also, I mean, you create a lot of work. It's hard to keep track of it. Like the kind of linear way that we track filmmakers now, you know, with IMDb pages does not encompass everything that you've been creating on a multimedia level. You've got art shows going on and you do short films. What keeps you going? You know, how restless do you get? Because, you know, making a movie takes a long time, takes resources.
Yeah, I don't even like making movies. And like, I don't even really watch movies anymore. I mostly like paint and go fishing, like stare out at the water. I live on a house, there's like manatees in the backyard. I bought this electronic poker machine. I just sit on that a lot for hours a day. But I don't fuck with like IMDb pages.
But eventually you get work done too.
And then I would do work.
I mean, you make a lot of short films.
I make short films. I try to do everything. I try to keep myself active. I got the Tom Hanks typewriter app, and I just been writing great poems on that.
And kind of similar to the character in The Beach Bum, except yeah. He has an actual typewriter.
Yeah, but I just use the Tom Hanks app.
It's a little easier.
It's just cool. It's just like I think of when I write, I think of how would Tom Hanks write a poem?
It's an interesting open-ended question. But going back to the short film of it all, we do have one here. And it's a really neat opportunity to screen it because I think it's only shown at the Pompidou in France, which just did a big retrospective of all your work.
Yeah.
So. Can you just like tell us a little bit about the short and kind of set up the context before we take a look?
Yeah, so this was a short. I had, what's that called, shrooms? Yes. Yeah, but this dude I know that sells shrooms. Well, anyway, I won't get into that. But this is a short. It's something I filmed in Florida like 2 years ago. I'm trying to think what it's about. It's called it's called Drumass. You know, like it's a play on dumbass. But it's called Drumass. And one of the guys is from Russia. Anyway, hope you enjoy it.
You'll figure it out. So let's take a look. It's a North American premiere of Drumass.
Thank you.
said something.
Thank you.
So that neon palette, really, I mean, anybody who's seen Spring Breakers, you can sense the continuity there. How do you go about conveying to somebody what you're going for on that level? Because it's such a precise kind of visual motif.
Yeah, it's like making paintings. It's like you have a palette, there's colors, there's a vibration, there's like a mood, there's a diffusion, there's like a... it's just this specific thing that you like, that you see, you're attracted to. So when we're working with like the cinematographer on that, Maddie, who's like one of the best.
Matthew Liebetik, who shot A Star Is Born, is out right now.
Yeah, he's amazing. And it's like when you work with guys that are like, or like Benoit Dabit, when you work with guys like Benoit or Maddie or something, it's like you can paint pictures. And so like you're able to express yourself with light and form and shadows and colors and stuff in a way that is exciting. So yeah, you design it beforehand.
And the thing that's also kind of fascinating about that is that you now have access to these incredible people, not just who wants to be in front of the camera, but these below the line artists who might get some work working on more conventional stuff. I mean, what is it like for you to actually be able to know you can tap into what these people are doing and give them something that's totally different?
Like, yeah, it's awesome being me.
Care to elaborate? but it also, like, in bigger picture, I mean, you know, Beach Bum was not a small movie. You know, you had a big set of people working on that. You know, that's a lot to deal with, a lot to juggle.
No, it's a lot of juggling. I mean, it's cool. It's like, it's great. I love it. You can just toss some shit out there. People want to sign up. It's a good thing, because you do enough work that people like. You put enough stuff out there that's interesting, and maybe it's not what everyone does normally. And they see merit in it, and they feel like they can contribute in a way that's something they don't do often. A lot of times, I'm always pleasantly surprised that people, Jimmy Buffett is in the movie. That's a good example. I was like, love Jimmy Buffett. He's never done anything like that movie ever. I had no idea, you know, if he would do something like that. He's like a hero of mine, and we went out to Jimmy, and, you know, he's in the movie. And it's like, for me, when I see him on the screen, it's like a dream. It's great.
And what compels you to take a step back from these kind of situations to do something on a smaller scale? Like, for example, when you made Trash Humpers for no money, you know, acting in it in your neighborhood, shot it on, you know, low-res video. Yeah. I mean, what?
Because I care. I don't care about, like, high culture, low culture. I don't care about budget, this and... This is big, this is small, it's like I try to do things where I think it's fun. If it's fun and I feel like I can express myself in a good way, whatever the budget, if it's $100 million or $100, if I feel like I can like hit it and I can like something that I want to try, then I don't really think the rest will come. So movies are an artwork and things that they're a reflection of your mood at the moment, or at least of my mood. I try not to. I'm not one of those directors who like. I'm always suspicious of directors who have like 10 projects out, or even artists who are like, you know, I can sit there and look at these fucking dinners, and you know, these guys are always talking about 50 scripts that they have optioned, and I'm going to like 20. You know, I got 7 movies I'm going to direct with this, because like I don't understand that logic, because like every year I feel differently about life and about making things and who I am and where the world is. So like I could never imagine being attached to 5 projects for the next X amount of years, because how do I know what I'm going to be like next year, or the things that I like now are going to suck in 2 years, you know? And so I never know anything, really. I don't design it. I just do something, and then as soon as I'm done, I really like look around. I'll just live life too. To be honest with you, I just like to live. I don't even really like to work. So I'd rather just hang out.
Well, the Beach Bum is done. So have you started kind of figuring out what your next move is, movie-wise?
Yeah, I want to make that movie Cocoon, a remake. Cocoon 2. They shot that in Florida.
There's a lot of good horror reboots going on these days, so the timing is good.
Yeah. Children of the Corn.
Children of the Corn or Cocoon, you got to choose one.
Children of Cocoon. I think we just figured it out.
Crowdsourced it.
Children of Cocoon. That's a great title.
So I wanted to ask you about one project that nobody here has seen because it never really got finished, but I think it's sort of relevant to this discussion because you went through so many interesting different stages as a filmmaker where you were trying things. And one of these things that you tried in the late 90s was this thing called Fight that never really got finished. What can you tell us about this thing that, you know, if you go to internet fan sites, people are obsessed with it?
I might start to show it soon, start to show thing. I'm starting to come around to it. but it's a movie where I used to provoke people to beat me up on the street. You know, you would just go up and I would just start, you know, you'd start. I wanted to be like, I thought it was like Buster Keaton, and I wanted to make a movie that consists entirely of just me getting in fights. And then, because I thought the essence, and I felt like the essence of humor was really just this, there was a tragedy to everything. A guy slips on a banana peel, falls, it's hilarious, but the dude broke his leg. So I wanted to make a film where I just got pummeled. But I got arrested and, you know, hurt and stuff, and thrown into psych wards, and it was like, my family was concerned, and so I... that was, you know, a trippy time for me, and I was like, all right, I got to check out. But I, you know, I have a lot of that footage.
How much footage is there?
I mean, because the fights are short, so, and I wanted it to be a feature. I wanted it to be 90 minutes and play in, you know, the malls next to Chick-fil-A. And so I didn't realize how short they last. And you know, a long, it's like a 90 seconds is long. So I did about 10, 12. But it's probably just accumulated less than 15 minutes of pure brutality.
And people have obsessed with this thing for a long time, but it's like, there's nothing, it's unlike so much that's being documented these days, there's nothing on YouTube. You know, you can't torrent it.
That's why I always go back and forth, because the idea of it sometimes is more interesting than, I think, than the images. But
how much assurance can you give people who are obsessed with this thing that it is real, that this footage exists?
Oh, well, I could show like 10 seconds on my phone.
The front row is going to get quite a show right now.
Hold on. Let me scroll. I got a phone. Nobody's filming, right?
Camera's down.
I gotta find it first. Oh shit, that's... Sorry. It stays in Key West.
So you want me to hold it up? You wanna tell us what we're seeing? Should I narrate?
You can narrate.
So Harmony is sort of walking around the street, chirping in a way, with his arms flapping around, and he's throwing himself at a taxi, and he's crossing the street, and he just ran into some guy who looks really baffled, and they just pushed him away. Now he's thrown himself into a car door, and they're pushing him out of the car. They really don't want him to get into this car.
All right, that's good.
We got the world premiere of some part of Fight. That's not too bad. So I want to leave some time for questions from the audience. In the spirit of the Beach Bone, we have a hard out at 4:20. So there should be plenty of time to cover a lot of ground. Just shoot your hand in your ear if you have a question for Harmony, and make sure to project, because it's a big theater, right in the front row.
What's up, dude? I put that.
Can you tell us what he just said?
He's in the Beach Bum. He's like in the he's in the opening scene with Matthew. Yeah, he's dangling from. You haven't seen the movie, but He's dangling from, what is that? Not a gondola, a basket. He's naked playing the guitar on the ocean. Oh no, that's the other one, the other characters. Yeah, and yeah, he's playing like a ZZ Top guitar. But remember, but he was dangling out there for a few hours. He's still pissed. He was pissed.
I hope he made the final cut.
He made the cut.
Yeah, way back there, and then we'll work our way back up.
No, I mean, I never thought about that, but yeah, there's like, it does, there's like maybe even a little like Night of the Hunter vibes in there now that I was watching it, but I don't think I ever like consciously reference films or talk about them with, when I set out to make something, I'm not really usually talking about or thinking about other films, but I always think that all those movies like live inside you. You know, I was a kid of the movies. That's all I did for a long time, was watch them. So they're part of you.
And it's worth noting also, your dad was a filmmaker. So
yeah.
That had an impact on
you. Yeah, my dad had done documentaries and stuff. So I spent a lot of time like watching him make documentaries.
There was a hand somewhere over here, yeah, back in the front row.
Oh yeah, Happy's. And the Coke vibes there are intense, dude. The fucking the rails in that place. Yeah, there was a couple of people there with no septum. Like, Happy's, the Stork Lounge. That place is great. I mean, I think I would like to be like one of the mascots, promoters of that. I believe when hurricanes come, they do like hurricane parties at that place and do lock-ins, right? It's great. I mean, I wish there were more places like that. Only in Miami. Key West, sorry. This part of the Florida. Yeah, Key West.
Yes, sir.
No, I like wank it and go to sleep.
Discipline. Yes, ma'am.
I just want to say we're from Nashville, and in your movie, you pumped our trash can.
I thought I recognized your trash can. We humped the hell out of that thing. Oh, Travis. Yeah, he's in there. What part of what? Did you probably live near my house? That's probably why. Yeah, because I grew up on Belmont, right across the street on Beechwood. Yeah, so we definitely hit it up. Yeah, I'll give you 10 cents.
It's about the budget of the movie, right?
That's a cheap fuck.
How did you notice this when you went to go see the film?
Or yeah, how did you notice? Jizz. Me too. That's awesome you guys came out, though. That's great. That's cool.
Other questions from the crowd right here.
When you worked in Little Project with your friends and colleagues and all that, did you pay them all? Or did they really go low?
No, we tried to pay millions. No, but yeah, you try to give as much as you possibly can. Always millions.
Well, I mean, you've worked with like non-actors, and then you've worked with big actors. Some people are just doing favors for you and stuff, right?
Totally. Do I pay for the equipment?
No, the crew and all that.
Yeah.
Yeah, you work with friends, you work with family, you work with people you don't know, you work with enemies.
Everybody gets paid at the end of the day. Other questions? Yes.
What? What'd she say?
Can you repeat the question? We couldn't hear it.
What happened?
Did the blue macaw make it into the...
The what? Oh, the... Whoa, that was a crazy, weird way to question. I thought you said, did you cob on a parrot? What was the thing? What was the question?
Did the parrot?
Parrot stars in this bitch. He's a co-star. He's got his own title.
Did you pay the parrot? That's the question.
It's a parrot head.
Do we have other questions from the audience? All right, well, Harmony, congratulations.
Man, I just want to say thanks, Key West. Smoke it up. Live it up. I love this place. It's my second home. And it's actually my first home, but I just don't live here. And I love it. I mean, I love it. And so this is a blast. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.